Good afternoon. Welcome to my lecture recital on executing broken chords and arpeggios on the marimba and baroque style. Before I begin, I'd like to thank Parkway High School United Methodist Church for letting this beautiful facility to do this in. And I apologize, this is about as cool as it's going to get. We really only when we have to. Performers of notated art music are constantly asking themselves, what are the composer's intentions? It is not enough to merely play music exactly as it is notated, no matter how ambiguously or specifically it is written. To produce a meaningful and moving performance, musicians must add what is not written. This can be as simple as playing music, how it feels, primarily relying on one's intuition, or it may be as involved as exhaustive research into the performance history of the work. Listening to significant players in concert, as well as on recordings, and studying performance editions are an adequate start. Treatises of the time are invaluable, and scholarly interpretations of these treatises are equally of importance. Still, with all these resources and performers at home, each individual is left with choices, and with more knowledge comes more choices. My lecture will present a series of choices regarding the performance of broken chords and arpeggios with Johann Sebastian Bach's Fuga from Sonata No. 1 in G minor, BWV1001, and the Ciaccona from Partita No. 2 in D minor, BWV1004. Sergei Rachmaninoff. Baroque music is not nearly as controlling in its notation as post-Baroque music. The Baroque composer left many decisions up to the discretion of the performer. These may include diatonics, articulation, phrasing, or ornamentation, just to mention a few. For example, Bach wrote not a single dynamic indication in either of the works to be performed here today, but it is entirely appropriate and actually expected to add crescendos, decrescendos, or any other volume changes where one sees fit. In the entire set of violins and sonatas and partitas, Bach indicated quartet and piano only when he wanted sudden dynamic shifts for a studio effect, and even this was sparse and sometimes assuming, usually dependent upon the music being played. The only articulation indication in these works today are spurs, considered by most to be simply bones. And throughout the years, even those have differed from performer to performer. Phrasing can be determined by the material that is supplied. For example, meter, tempo, harmonic motion, melody, title, the desired affect, all these things can have a bearing on phrasing. In the Baroque, tempo is dictated by the time signature, and if applicable, the style of dance the work was based on. But even this was flexible in the stylized dances of the German Baroque. It was also appropriate for the performer to use rubato, but only sparingly. Important cadences and ends of large phrases are very fine places to use tempo rubato, but one may also stretch within the measure or within a short phrase as long as it is not overdone. Ornaments, especially frills, were sometimes written and sometimes not, but they were expected in certain cases, like strong cadences, the ends of large sections. Performers could choose a trill beginning or ending unless otherwise indicated by the composer through the accepted trill signs of the time. Other ornaments, such as appoggiaturas, accacciaturas, mordants, are only appropriate in cases where there is enough space rhythmically to include them. During passages of excessive counterpoint or faster rhythmic activity, one should avoid adding excessive ornamentation. The subject of this lecture, however, is to be the Baroque performance practice of chords, played in a broken manner, and arpeggios. For a violinist, any chord from Bach's sonatas and partitas containing two or more pitches was usually executed in a broken manner. The exception being three-note chords, which could sometimes be played simultaneously on a baroque violin. On the other hand, a marimbist has a luxury of choice because any chord can be played broken or not. This does pose the first of the two performance practice issues I will address in this lecture. How scalar figures, and other elements not provided by the bass line and corresponding figures. I believe basso continuo ideas can be used to vary one's choices when realizing arpeggio passages. Based on my research, I have established some parameters for breaking chords and executing arpeggios in a historically informed manner. These are not rules per se, but rather suggestions to help the percussionist make educated choices when transcribing Bach to the Baroque. Parameters for breaking chords. Chords can and should be broken in a variety of ways. When executing broken chords, one should strive for rhythmic ambiguity and variety so the listener will not confuse broken chords with notated rhythms. Two common ways to play broken chords are from lowest to highest. Highest to lowest. And of course, there are a number of other ways which I will discuss later. Chords can be broken according to the placement of the melody, usually with the melody note serving as the first or last note of the broken chord. For example, if the melody is in the top voice, one can break the chord from low to high. If the melody is in the bass, then high to low. If you will now turn to example one, I will now perform the melody, which is in the soprano, in the first four measures of example one. This time without the chords accompanying. Thank you. chords on strong beats should be broken more often than chords on weak beats and up beats. For the sake of variety, chords on strong beats should be broken more openly than weak beats as well. Weak beat chords should be broken rather rapidly and much softer than strong beat chords. The Ciaccona is characterized by emphasis on count two, so therefore one should play chords on count two stronger and more openly than chords on count one. I will play the first eight measures of the D minor Ciaccona, and now notice not only that it's in volume, but in the manner in which the chords on counts one and two are broken. Measure 1/8 of example two will provide you a visual approximation.
Thank you.
because it's reminiscent of the 16th note variations found earlier in the major mode section of this movement. I will now play measures 201 through 208 of example 10. Thank you. If a performer has more choices, then he has the ability to communicate more meaningfully to me. But the performer must not always make choices arbitrarily or intuitively. Intuition and feeling are useful tools at times, and it is very likely that all great performers have a very strong intuition. But making a choice will allow the performer to become closer to the music and the composer, and then the performer and the music become one, and then no communication can occur. To all musicians in the audience today, never settle for one way to play anything. Please remember, after the notes and rhythms are learned, you are left with no right or wrong way to play anything. You are left only with ways. And now before I go to the performance aspect part of this recital, I would now like to open the floor for any questions or discussion that anybody might have. Okay. If there are no questions, I'll be available afterwards. If there are no questions, I will now conclude with the performance of Johann Sebastian Bach.
Thank you.